Of days. Lift your hands and pray. Lift your hands and pray. Thank you, Jesus. Lift your hands. Lift your hands. Say, Father, I am here. Touch my life. Change my situation. In Jesus' name. Amen. Put up two hands for Jesus. Hallelujah. I want to welcome everybody who's watching us on Facebook. May God bless you. I want you to share the page. God is going to be doing amazing things. Listen, you will never tap to what you are not connected to. Connectivity is by faith. A lot of miracles happen on the platform of connectivity. The reason why we're having power is because we are connected somewhere. We are connected to the supply. Praise God. So there is a supply. There's a supply of the blessing. So connect yourself. Three things that I need in this class. Number one, your Bible. Can I see your Bible? Your Bible. Three things. notebooks. Can I see your notebooks? If you come here without notebook, I chase you, go home. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let me see. Wow, that's good. Let me see. Are you pregnant? You're pregnant. Don't want to eat from Gabon. I don't want to see this. But let me see. Like iPads, you know, people have got iPads, you know. That's, you know, technology. Huh? You are tapping into technology. Can I see? Yeah, that's good. Can I see all my notes? Tokens. Tokens. Impact is simply living a productive life. Dominion, resourceful life. It is living an eventful life. Number two, it's giving to humanity, adding to the kingdom of God. If you are not a giver, you are not impactful. It's simply producing results in any environment of no result. It's simply adding color to your generation. It's simply the ability to cause those that forgot you to remember you. What are tokens? These are simply materials that transfer, convey, release forces to an individual. They are These are instruments that convey the power of God face to face. They are spiritual gifts received from a human, from a man of God that represents him in your house. They are simply instruments of discharging the undeniable power of God over your life. They are divine instruments that enhance a man to accomplish his divine assignment or purpose in life with excellency. Number seven, they give service and add value to others, instruments of addition and multiplication. Wow. Wow. You're not clapping hands. Wow, this is nice. Tokens. Power will become a lifestyle and blessing will become a lifestyle. Tokens are instruments of spiritual reputation. You can never separate the power of God from token. Prophets are human tokens. Purpose is discovering your role in life. Wow, this is amazing. What is a covenant? Wow. Wow. This is just awesome. Is growing tonight. Do not forget my patches. Do not forget my patches. So Timothy was a writer. If you don't want to be forgotten in life, then be a writer. Praise the Lord. Put our two hands as we make welcome Apostle Terry as he comes to bless us with the word of God. Put our two hands for him. Clap your hands. Clap your hands.
Elect and God's people, and I want you to put your hands together for God's spokesman in this house, for the prophets, for the man of God, for the mouthpiece of God in this place. Come on, if you are not jealous, put your hands together for Prophet Didi Isaac. Come on, make some noise in this place. From this pulpit, I want to bless the name of the Lord for my spiritual father, Bishop George Asare, and with all due respect, I seriously honor him. He's the one who ordained me to the ministry as an apostle. He has ordained me, he has poured oil on my head, and he horn, and I want to thank God and celebrate God for his life. It's a blessing to me and my ministry, and above all, I want to thank God for the precious Holy Spirit who makes us who we are and through whom we are who we are. Amen. Now, quickly, I want you to take your Bible in the book of Ephesians chapter 6, verse 13 to 17. I don't have much time. I want to talk about some very mysterious things, because this church is a great church. It's a church whereby the man of God and the woman of God, when they stand here, they release divine mysteries. So I'm going to walk in the same path like them, and we're going to talk about some very brutal things. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 13 to 17. If the Bible you're using is yours, you can read it with me. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 13 to 17. Someone can read it for me. And I want you to follow carefully, because we are just going to read this passage and we are going to jump straight to the message, and then you will understand why I was making you read this Bible verse. Amen. So I want you to pay careful attention to what we're going to do tonight, because as you are seated there, something is coming to you. Amen. Without the revelation of covenant, the Hebrew word berit, and the word berit means in English a league, a confederation. So that is to say, when you are in a covenant with God, you may be smaller, God may be the greatest one, he may be the greater one, but as you come into an association, a confederation, a league with God, we no longer see your weaknesses, but we see your strength, because you no longer exist, is the greater one that is now showing himself forth through you. So you might have started as a weak person. You might have started the journey as someone without much resources, but because you entered into a covenant with someone who has all the resources, we no longer see your weaknesses, but we now see your strength. And for you to understand what I'm talking about, I'm going to travel back to Genesis, and Genesis is not talking about a head. That's the way, because there are things in the Bible that the people that translated the Bible found it difficult to be able to narrate it in our own words, in our current day's words. So when they were writing the words in French, they are saying au commencement. But in the Hebrew Bible, the first word in the Bible is Bereshit. The other day when I was here, I was explaining it. Bereshit is talking about like a hierarchy. So we have the head and we have what follows. So it's showing you a body. And in that body, you have the head and you have the other limbs of the body. So in that very beginning, in that head, that means in the mind of God, when everything started, it started with blood. And then you never understood that till you traveled to the book of Revelation, where the Bible will not explain to you the lamb that was slain from the foundation of the world. Now, the book of Genesis didn't tell you that that lamb was actually slain, but it was at the end of the process that we understood that that lamb that was slain, it was actually slain even before the foundation of the earth. So if you don't follow carefully what we're going to talk about tonight, you may miss it, because we are going to use spiritual language to explain spiritual things. Hello. The one who had the revelation of the book of Genesis is called Moses. In Hebrew, it's Moshe. Moshe means someone taken from the waters. So God decided in his infinite mercy, no matter how the person was born, no matter the context, and he also used his own understanding. the heaven and the earth were without form and void. He didn't talk about the shape or the form of the heaven. He left it. Now, when we travel back to the book of John chapter 1, John will now explain to us what Moses was trying to say. When Moses was presenting the Messiah, he didn't have at that time the totality of the revelation of the Messiah. So he was using types and shadows. He was using descriptions to explain the revelation of the entirety of the Bible. Who is Christ? So he used his own words. So when Moses was there, he was saying, brazen serpent, blood on the post, because that was the revelation he had. But now when John received the revelation, he said, in the beginning was the Word. And the Word was without form. Sorry. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. So Moses, in his own words, was talking about the heaven and the earth. Now John, in the days of the revelation of the entirety of the scripture, which is Christ, he will not have the revelation to know that in that beginning, it was a word. So what you need in your life is a word. Even if you lose your earth, even if you lose your heaven, in quotes, when I mean heaven in quotes, your place of abundance, your place of delight, even if you have lost everything in life, whenever you come to such a church, which is a prophetic church, you got to be spiritually sensitive enough to understand that there is a word that has the ability to turn your life into what you ought to be. No matter how it started, when Moses said, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth was without form and void, and the Spirit of the Lord was hovering over the face of the deep, and there was darkness over the face of the waters, and God said. So the movement of the Spirit always precedes the word of God. And God said, what did God say? He said, let there be light. Now Moses was busy telling us about the problems about the creation. God was not busy telling us what he was about to do. So I have come in that shoes to speak over your life. Though there was darkness over your life, there was problem in the waters of your life. The waters of your life may be bitter, but God said, let there be sweetness. Let there be life. Let there be light in the name of Jesus. The Naba of God, the word Naba is a Hebrew word that talks about the prophet. The Naba of God was saying on Sunday, when he was talking about the waters, he said the water was called Mara, which means bitter in Hebrew words. So he went there and he said, give me salt. So it was a token. So the problem was big. The solution seemed foolish and smaller than even the problem. When you are busy thinking and talking about the width, the length, and the immensity of your problems, God is busy looking at you. When you will begin to shut up, Elohim will begin to speak. And so that man Abraham that was presented to us, he was presented with two names. Listen to what I'm saying carefully. The first name we were introduced to, it was Abram, before Abraham. Now the word Abram, it means an elevated father. And the word Abraham means father of multitude. Now follow me carefully. So in the days of Abraham, there were a whole lot into covenant and into blood rituals. So when God came to Abraham, he had to use the language of things that Abraham was acquainted with to tell him what he didn't know about life. So God began to explain things to Abraham, and Abraham understood because they were used to all these blood rituals. Because in those days, now I'm starting something, the Bible says, and God told Abraham, leave thy kindred, leave thy father's house, and go ye into the land I show to you. Now, Abraham was formerly an idol worshiper. He was from a family that they were worshiping the sun, the moon and the stars, which we call the element or the host of heaven. So they were used to blood rituals. They knew what it meant, and they know that without a covenant, it's impossible for nations to be strong. Because when you enter into a covenant, you are not trying to diminish your weakness and to increase your strength. So what they were doing, I'm quickly going to explain the ancient days civilization, the way they were going about covenant. What they were doing in those days is that this is a family, and she is also a family. So this family is strong, but this family is weak. So what they do is that, okay, we're going to come together and then enter into a covenant. That's why we always use the word enter into a covenant. But the real Hebrew meaning is to cut a covenant. The meaning is that the covenant is something, or the covenant is somebody that we have to cut. You will understand today. That's why the English word, we say we have to cut a covenant. It's only in French that is not well translated. But normally in English it says, let's cut a covenant. So you come, she comes, and then we're going to form what we call a league. Because I started by telling you that the word covenant in Hebrew is from the word berit. Berit means a league, a confederation. So when they come, first of all, they do what we call, they have to select a representative. Someone say a representative. Now this family will release a representative, and this other family will release a representative. And each representative must be somebody that when the family is looking at, all of them agree that, yes, this one, he can represent us. So there must be no controversy about the one that's supposed to be their representative. And then what they are going to do after that, they have to look at the representative. When outsiders are passing, outsiders, when they look at the representative, they must know which family he comes from. Because it is very important. Because each representative is going to play a very important role. And it's that representative that will give the strength of that word cult. Now, after the representative, I'm quickly going to jump some portions because I don't have much time. We have what we call number two. We have the place. So they have to select a place for the rituals whereby everybody can come, like you are here today. Everybody can sit down and look at everything that will be done, because it is an agreement between two parties. So all of them must watch what is going on, because they have to testify of what is going on and happening. So in the dispensation in which we are, Jesus is our representative. You understand why you can't be the representative? Jesus is our representative. So you are in a season of enjoyment. You are enjoying what you have not even observed. You are enjoying today what you have not watched. You were not there at Calvary when Jesus was cutting the covenant with God on our behalf. He represented you and I. He represented the entirety of the seed of Abraham. So number two is the place of the ritual. Now they chose a place. Was standing there on the cross at Golgotha. He was telling you and I that were not even born, look into what I have done. Lift up your eyes. That's why David had that revelation. He said, I lift up. This. Why, when you will rise up today and go home, you must walk with boldness, confidence, and assurance, because it is a done deal. You are just into a season of enjoyment. You are enjoying something that has been done. Jesus went to rest. He's in his seventh day. The Bible said on the seventh day, God did what? He rested. But wait, the Bible said he rested from his works. So that rest is not a sleep. It's not a nap. He went to rest from his work. It means God is seated in glory. He's not manufacturing anything in heaven. The same God in the days of Abraham that had the knowledge of plain didn't give the Abraham people the knowledge of plain. When the time came, he allowed that revelation to be gushed out. So we are in a season of enjoyment. Tell your neighbor, we are in a season of enjoyment. Now And the third thing, it was the sacrificial animals. These animals needed to be animals that contain a lot of blood. The blood needed to be many in their veins, because we needed, the blood was the evidence of the ritual. Because without blood, there is no ritual. Without blood, there is no covenant. Because that blood was the token. It was the stamp of the covenant. So what they were doing, they were cutting the animals from the back of the neck down the backbone to do something. You see, when you go to the butcher, they have a very sharp cutlass. They can use that cutlass to split an animal into two. So that's what they were doing with those animals, because the blood needed to gush out, because people were there looking at what is happening. So they needed to see an evidence. So sometimes the blood can even go to people's clothes. So you are seated there, and then you see, all of a sudden there is blood on me. So as you are seated here, there will be a mark of the blessing on you wherever you are seated. Because you are here and you have attended this service, I mean, you have attended. Can you make me say what I want to say?
Oh, yes.
Now, as you are here and you have attended this service, you are attending the defeat of your enemies and the celebration of your victory in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And then number four, which I want you to pay careful attention. It was the exchange of coats. Tell your neighbor, the exchange of coats. Now, you know what they do when they were doing the rituals? Please, I need two people. I need two people. Come. I want to explain something. What did I tell you in the beginning? Let's read which Bible passage? Ephesians chapter. You understand. Now, this one is the representative of the family Williams. So follow me carefully. And now let's call this one the representative of the family Berg. Hello? Follow me carefully. Now, Mr. William will remove his coat and give it to Mr. Berg. Now, Mr. Berg will remove his coat and give it to Mr. William. So it's an exchange. So on Mount Calvary, Jesus removed your weaknesses and he gave you his strength. On Mount Calvary, Jesus said, "It is finished." What was finished? Now, the question you have to ask yourself, what is finished? Because on the day Adam sinned, he gave the keys of that garden to the devil. Now, Jesus was saying, that dominion of the devil, it is over. And I stand in the apostolic mantle upon my life. And I stand in the prophetic mantle of the man of God. And I decree over your life, there will be an exchange tonight. Whatever God has not put in your life that the devil brought to you, I remove it and I take from God what God has ordained for you and I release it into your hands in the name of Jesus. So Mr. Berg, we say, wait, Mr. Williams, in our family we are richer than your family. But since today we have entered into a covenant, there is no longer family Williams, family Berg. We now call it Williamsburg. That's why you see in English, some of you don't know, you have these combinations of names. And you wonder where they come from. If you read history, you will trace it back. If you want to know the origin of Great Britain today, the United Kingdom, they were into wars back in those days. Now, they formed some unions. They formed some confederations. They entered into some covenant. That's why you have those very weird names, Edward Smith, Williamsburg. It was a combination of two different names. I will explain to you. So this one is removing his coat. And what was the coat? The coat was the symbol of authority and the symbol of their strength. Just like what the man of God was saying, it's a mantle. And we don't give mantle like that. So today, you are not in a dispensation where you are asking for the mantle of Elijah, like Elisha did. You have the mantle of Christ already. Now, the problem is, how will you activate it? Because you were born with that mantle. Elisha had to follow Elijah to receive the mantle. You were born with a mantle in your hand because you have in you the DNA of Yeshua HaMashiach, the Son of the living God. And he calls you co-heir. So do you know there is a bank where they have registered a bank account with your name on it? They call you co-heir. It means there is something somewhere for you. Until you understand it, you will never enter into possession of it. It's already done. It's already done. Solomon said there is nothing new under the sun. Everything you need has been done. God is not creating cars. In heaven, there is no car manufacturer. God is not a car manufacturer. No. Man of God, have you seen cars in heaven? As a matter of fact, we will walk in heaven because the roads of heaven are paved with gold. So even Bugatti, Ferrari, they are not entitled to drive there because it's precious gold. A gold that is so pure, you can even see yourself into it like a mirror. So imagine the kind of glory we will be in heaven. So you will see my house in heaven. You will see the house of Prophet Didi. My house is covered with gold. The gold human beings are fighting for on this earth, God has not. See, our God we serve. Do you know God doesn't use rand? If not, God would have been a South African. But in UK also, people pray God. Now, is God a user of pounds? No. Now, in the United States of America, people pray God. Which currency do they use? Dollar. Now, in my country, or I mean that region I'm from, because that's also a trick. An international trick organized. We use what you call CFA. Now, that CFA is a currency used by 8 countries in West Africa. Also in Central Africa, they have also some group of countries using the same currency. It has the same value. So, we also pray God. We call him Dieu in French. Now, is God a Frenchman? No. There are some countries that use escudos, most of these Spanish countries. Is God a Spanish man? No. He told Moses. Moses said, if they ask me who you are, now the man that spoke to you, who is he? What shall I say? Tell them, I am that I am. Ah, I am that I am. It means Moses, whoever you want me to be, I am. If you are sick, I am Rapha. If you lost your way, I am Roy. It means the shepherd. If you are unclean, if you are defied, I am called Mekadishkem. It means the God that sanctified. Moses, if you are broke, I am Jehovah Jireh. So whoever you want me to be, I am. So if you take the side of God that is Rapha, you will have Rapha. You will be healed, but you can be broke. Because you have refused or denied the part of God which is Jireh. So you can have also money. It means you can walk in the Jireh, you can walk in the Rapha. You have money, you are healthy, but you are lost. You don't know your way because you have refused the part of God which is Roi. It means the shepherd. So instead of taking God 1%, take him 100%. Since you could not, Jesus on your behalf became a representative of the family of sinners. And then he reconciled us back to God. And he stood on that wood and he said, it is finished. And the Bible said the veil that was in the temple in those days, because that was the place, that veil was stopping people from having access to the Holy of Holies. He said, the Bible said the veil in that temple, like this big one that is here, it was torn. Nobody went to bring it down. It was torn into pieces. It means now you guys have access to what you didn't have access to. So you might have come here without having access to money, but you, as you have entered this church, I say, as you have entered this church today, your covenant, this one takes his coat, he gives it to this one. This one takes his coat, he gives it to this one. Now they are telling, we are one. Your battle is my battle. That is why when you read David, he could say, Jehovah Sabaoth, he is the mighty man in battle. Because David had the password of the weaponries of God. Do you know how I know it? When he was before Goliath, when you read the Bible, I beg you, always try to see Jesus through the scriptures. Because the entirety of this book called the scriptures is about Jesus. And I will show you one or two things today that will shock you. Because the man of God said, Apostle, tell them something. I was even supposed to travel today. He said, no, stay. You have to come and say something. So it means something will come to you today. Whether you like it or not, I have come with an anointing. It is compulsory for you to be blessed. Even if they have poured acid of curses on your head, I decree the oil of God, the oil of blessing will be released on your head. No matter who spoke over you, I decree today, in the anointing of this house, you are compelled to be blessed. When he stood before Goliath, he said, you, I'm going to cut down your heads and give it to the birds. He said, wait, so you call me a dog? He didn't call the man a dog. So when the man said he's a dog, immediately in the realms of the spirits, the angels began to enter into the computer of heaven and say, let's look at the weapons used to kill dogs. When they look at weapons used to kill dogs, they found what we call stone. So David went to the website of heaven and he downloaded 5 stones. He didn't even use the 5 stones. He used 1. He said, you call yourself dog. So whoever you say you are, I will use something that is in alignment with it to kill you. So when the battle began to be fierce, Goliath said, I mean, the Bible even told me that it was Goliath who said it because I was not there. That Goliath cursed David with his God. Now, he has forgotten something. If you want to fight somebody, fight him alone. Don't fight the one behind him. So immediately, when he cursed David with his God, David walked out of the battle. He said, Oga God, they are calling you in this battle. Because this is no longer a battle of human beings. This man is using his gods to curse me. My God, where are you there? They are calling you. So since he was using God, his gods, to curse David, now David walked out. He said, Oga God, now come. So David became a spectator of his own battle. Now, a professor, can I prophesy in your life? You will sit down, cross your leg, but God will fight for you. I said tonight, you will sit down comfortably and you will behold the reward of the wicked. That's why the same David could say, and behold the reward of the wicked, but I shall be exalted on high. Because he know, he said, I will behold. It means I will go and sit down. That's why I said, sit down, cross your legs, say, I'm in charge. Because indeed you are in charge. Because he forgot God is a God of covenant. Now, no matter where you are, no matter what you go through, because of the covenant, any situation you find yourself into, heaven can come down to you. So family Williams and family Bergs, they're into covenant. So the 15th down that will happen, listen to it carefully as I'm about to close. Now, you know what? That's the most interesting part of that covenant. The man of God, that's the most interesting part. Tell your neighbor, that's the most interesting part. Now, you know what they will do? That's where the serious business is starting. They will go and use a very sharp stone or a very sharp knife, and then they will just cut their veins. Hello? Now, Mr. William will cut on this part of his arm. He will cut it. So this is where you have the veins, right? Now, the blood will gush out. Mr. Beg will also do the same. And then they will join their hands together. As from today, by this blood, your battle is my battle. Your problems are my problems. And you know what they do with those scars? Instead of leaving it like this, they so much want the scars to be a serious token. They will go and use gunpowder. Do you know gunpowder? And they will rub it on the incision. imagine the scar, the way it will be. So my number 5 point is the scar of the ritual. Now, because they want to provoke a sign on the body. When everybody sees it, they know that these people, they have entered into terrible things. That is why when Jesus resurrected, he resurrected in glory, but we were still seeing the sign of the nails of the cross to show you that indeed it is finished. So that was a terrible talking. When he was walking and he's doing like this, it's just like a stamp on a legal document. You can have that document until there is a stamp. It's like it's fake. The stamps now brings a serious approval, a legal approval on the document. So by so doing, they were now approving the covenant and telling them, behold, this is what is happening. And after these scars, you have what you call number 6 now. Is it number 6? In number 6 now, they have the exchange of name. Ha ha ha. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. That is why you and I, people, you can see them. We have the name of who? Of Jesus. And the man of God can stand here and say, in Jesus' name, wherever you are, I decree you are free. And you are free because your name is not relevant in the name of in the realms of the spirit. It is the name of Jesus. And since now you are called Christian, it means little Christ. You can use the name of Jesus Christ because he has given you his name. There was an exchange of name. So in the realms of the spirit, you don't appear with the name Williams. You don't appear with the name Berg. When you come, you say, in the name of Jesus. That's what David said. He said, thou comest against me with sword and spear, but I come against thee in the name of the Lord of hosts that you have insulted. So you have the name of Christ. That is why if you read the book of Revelation, by the time of the rapture, his name will be written on our foreheads. Because you will never be called. You will no longer be called by your own name. You will not be called Susan. You will not be called Thierry. You will not be called Henry. You will be called Jesus. So imagine how many Jesuses we will have in heaven. When I will see my brother, I will go to his house because I've already given him the address of my house in heaven and he has given me his address in heaven. Now I will go to him. I will say, Brother Jesus, how are you? Brother Jesus now will also greet me and say, Brother Jesus, I am fine. So we are all brothers and sisters, Jesus. He has given us his name and he has given us his nature. That is what the Bible said, as he is, not as he was. Because he's talking about the resurrection of Christ. He said, as he is, so are we in this world. And the last and the 7th point, which is the most brutal, is the covenant meal. After these families have entered into covenant, what they will now do? They will share a meal. Do you know what the meal was? It was bread and blood. And wine, sorry. It was bread and wine. So at the end of the celebration, the last of it all, to show that indeed we have testified a ceremony, a ritual ceremony. Behold, we are now into covenant. They hand it with bread and wine. Now, when Jesus was about to go to the cross, he shared the last meal with you. Upon the and sit down. And then when you look at the life of Joseph, is the last event of the life of Joseph that will make you understand the entirety of the revelation behind the character. Now God said when he was in prison, he was with two people. Say two people. One was the butler and the second one was the baker. Now the butler stands for the one pouring wine in the cup of Pharaoh. Hello? And the baker is the one baking bread for Pharaoh. So it was a shadow and a type of Christ. Joseph being used as the example. That's why the Bible said these were shadows of things to come. So do you know what Joseph said? He said, when you will come out of here, remember me. And in every covenant, there is always a part of remembrance. That's why there must be scars to show that something has happened. Now, the mysterious part of it all is that you can never kill blood. Note that. But you can kill the body. The one that was standing for blood, which is the butler, Pharaoh reinstated him back to his former position. But the one that was standing for bread, the baker, he died. And Joseph said specifically, he said, 3 days after, Pharaoh will lift up your head and you will be reinstated back to your former post. That was the symbol of the death. 3 days in the belly of the earth, Jesus had to spend. And on the third day, God raised him from the dead. But they killed the body. So the baker was killed. He said, he will put your head on top. That means you will die, you the bread. But you can't kill blood. Do you know why? I was making some research searches and I found out something very terrible. Do you know in Hebrew how we call blood? If I tell you, you'll be shocked. But the actual word for blood in Hebrew is dam. D-A-M. I said, my God. So it's like a bridge connecting one portion to the other. Connecting one party to the other. So through the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Christ, you were weak. That's why he said, let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich. So if you continue to say you are rich, it is your problem. Because faith is not saying what you go through, it's saying what you want to go through. Hello? Faith is not saying what you go through. You go through sickness, but you say, I'm healed. How does that sound? Does it not sound like foolishness? You are broke. You say, I'm rich. Brother, I am rich. Brother, I am rich. But we don't see the money in your pocket. And then the second event that goes in alignment with this is the life of Samson. Some of you will be shocked today. Do you know where I saw Jesus in the life of Samson? It was after he went to Timnah. The Bible says he went to Timnah with his father and his mother. And then a young lion met him. Where three? The lion met him. When you were going through the toughest time of your life that everyone abandoned you, it's normal. You're not going through a new thing. It is normal. They have abandoned Samson. You know what Samson did? No, you the lion. I will go and call my dad. I will go and call my mom. He didn't say that. The Bible said he turned the lion into pieces like a little goat. That word shocked me. How can you with your hands, kill a lion and tear him like paper? I prophesy upon your head and upon your soul. Whoever will rise against you, they will be torn into pieces. They will be shattered into pieces. Whoever will come against you, I decree that will bring your promotion, that will bring your elevation, that will bring your miracle. That lion forgot that Samson had a covenant upon his life. That is why you can see how dangerous the covenant is. In the middle of the toughest time of his life, despite the fact that even God took his hand from him, the covenant was still at work. So the covenant is the only thing that made God not look at your current status, because God is a faithful God. Your unfaithfulness can never make God be unfaithful. No. It is a covenant. And the reason why we have the better covenant is because in those days, after all, I've explained to you the 7 stages of covenant. Then now in the terms of the covenant, there are blessings that make people keep and remain in the covenant, and there are curses. So the fear of the curses make people remain in the covenant. But in our dispensation, there are no curses, because Christ became a curse that we might enjoy the blessings of Abraham. That's what the book of Galatians chapter 3 verse 13 downward says. He said that the blessings of Abraham might be ours. So you are in a better covenant. And that covenant does no longer depend on what you do or what you don't do. That is why we must not take grace for granted. We are enjoying the days of grace like never before. So we have to be careful also. That is why if you read the Bible said, if God does not judge this generation, I mean, you have to go and forgive Sodom and Gomorrah. Because we are enjoying maximum grace. Now, how do we undo that grace? You come, you pray, you ask. But do you know that all you are asking for has already been released even before you open your mouth and ask God? Do you know that? He has done all already. On that cross, he said, it is finished. So the whole thing is a rebroadcast. I was preaching a message like this. I said, life is a rebroadcast. Life is a rebroadcast. It is finished. So when something is finished, like when we go to the house of the prophet, the service we watch in his house is not the service, it's a rebroadcast. Because he himself is seeing himself in the TV. So how can you be seated in your house and you see yourself? So Prophet Didi is watching Prophet Didi. It's a rebroadcast. Tell your neighbor, life is a rebroadcast. So what you are going through is not new. In heaven, it's already recorded that you are blessed. It's already recorded that you have your twins. You have your babies. It's already recorded that whatever you want has been freely given to you. It's already recorded. Now, how do you understand and perceive it? He said to them that receive him, he gave them power. So if you don't receive him, there is no power for you. So the man was there and he was walking. That was the first step. The second step, the Bible said, he didn't tell his mom and his dad what he did. That was the first mistake of Samson. And I want to use it to correct something. You know, when you are walking with people that have seen what you have not seen, or that can see what you don't see, please, your mouth should also tell them what you have to tell them before it gets worse. The most difficult, the most complicated human beings on earth are people around a prophet. Because it is very dangerous to work with a highly spiritual man and to be highly carnal. It's like going the opposite direction. He was with his dad and his mom. Do you know what he decided to do? He didn't tell them what he did. He should have told them. Because in the covenant, it was stated, Samson, you should never touch a carcass. Samson, you should never touch a dead animal. Samson, no blade, no razor should touch your head. The man went against all the rules. So you've got to be careful when you work with such people, with such anointed men and women of God, that you want to hide things. Those things you are hiding, there will later be a bomb in your clothes. They can blast you. This is not a preaching. I've come to teach, so I've come to talk. I've got to say this because I'm very sensitive to spiritual things. You have to be careful of the atmosphere in which you are. Because you can pollute your atmosphere even though the atmosphere is good. Because we carry a collective atmosphere, but you carry an individual atmosphere on your head. But the most interesting part in the covenant is that despite all his mistakes, you know what God did? The lion that came against him, God went to put all the blessing of Samson in that lion. That's why he could find honey in the belly of that lion. So there are things coming against you. The situation you are currently going through that seems difficult. Oh, Papa. Hey, Papa, it's too difficult. There are things, Papa, I can't even tell you. You are sure that you will tell him something he has never heard. Oh, Papa, this thing I'm going through. Oh, if I tell you, Yusuf, you will be shocked. He cannot be shocked. He has heard more than that. What you are going through is only carrying your blessing. So the situation you are going through currently is pregnant with your blessing. So there are things, you know, when a woman goes to the hospital, is either she delivers or we make her deliver. Hello? If the woman doesn't have the strength to deliver, they will open the woman, right? So I have come today as a spiritual surgeon to open the belly of time and seasons and to remove your blessing. Whatever is present.
with your miracle. Whatever is pregnant with your babies. Whatever is pregnant with your job. Whatever is pregnant with your promotion. I decree, I use the knife of God. I use the sword of the word of God. And I open the belly of time and season. By this time tomorrow, you will carry your miracle. By this time tomorrow, you will carry your job. By this time tomorrow, you will have your employment letter. By this time tomorrow, you will carry your promotion letter. By this time tomorrow, the man who left you with your children, he will return back to you in the name of Jesus.
I close because my time is up. Judges chapter 14, verse 14. Let's all read like a mass choir. I want us to read it like a mass choir. I wish I could preach because I just came to teach. I want to preach. Prophet, can I preach? Can you give me 5 minutes? I want to preach because I don't want to blow myself. I must preach. Power. Judges chapter 14, verse 14. Let's read it like a mass choir. Like a one-man show. 1, 2, go. All of us with him. Amen. That was Jesus in the life of Samson. Hello. He said for 3 days, they could not explain the riddle. And I was saying one day about this, Judges chapter 14, I used it to preach. I said the riddle was settled. I didn't say the riddle will be settled. The riddle was settled. They said for 3 days, they couldn't explain it. He said out of the eater came something to eat. Now out of the belly of the earth, the one they have swallowed on that day at Golgotha, they didn't know he was the one that would go and open the earth and bring out. That's why the Bible said he led captivity, captives. So they were captives there. By carrying all of us our sins, Jesus had the number one authorization to enter into hell. He became the champion sinner on that day. He carried you and I, our sins, past sins, present and future. You were not even born, but this one was for you also, right? Jesus on the cross, he went to die for you and I. Were you born on that day? In those days, were you there? So can you see how powerful a covenant is? A covenant is an everlasting agreement between two parties. Because wherever blood is involved, the deal becomes everlasting. I repeat, wherever blood is involved, the deal becomes an everlasting deal. Let me say it again. Wherever blood is involved, the deal becomes an everlasting deal. You were not born, but he was doing it for you also. You are enjoying a season of uncommon and outstanding grace and pleasure and blessings. When he died, it entered into the depth and the belly of the earth. He said, where are they, the captives? Because Satan thought he was trying to twist the plan of God. God is orchestrating things. God is the master planner. He's the one that sees the future in the past. And the one that can make a past a future. And he can make a future a story. He forgot that. He was in heaven. But there are things he forgot about Jehovah Adonai. He forgot things about him because you cannot decode God. See, how can you comprehend and apprehend and understand this great God? He revealed himself as types and shadows throughout the scriptures. Moses had a revelation. Micah had a revelation. Zephaniah had a revelation. Habakkuk had a revelation. Isaiah had a revelation. When Isaiah was talking about Jesus, the name Jesus could not come out. He was saying, the virgin, the barren shall conceive. The barren shall conceive. It shall be called Emmanuel. God has encrypted the name of Jesus in the book of Isaiah. And he called it Emmanuel. Now, he didn't understand that God was not trying to let him know about a name. God was busy talking about a presence. He said, God with us. So the word Emmanuel means God is with us. So now the God with us, now we come in the book of Matthew chapter 1. And how will it be showed? And I want to conclude with this. That's why I was asking the permission. I want to preach. Now you might be born in a family with all kinds of disastrous and dangerous men and women. But you are the choice of God. If we read the genealogy of Jesus, I will show you and talk about two people now. It will shock you. In the genealogy of Jesus, there was a woman called Rahab. She was a prostitute, a shower. So when we talk about covenant, only a covenant can make someone that was a non-entity have an identity of favor. Only the covenant tonight that Jesus got with God on our behalf on the cross will make you move where you are and you will go to your palace. Amen. I am prophesying to 200 people today. I am prophesying to you. You are moving from that house you don't want into the house you want. You are moving from where you are into where you ought to be. In the name of Jesus. Daughter-in-law of Judah. And the father-in-law went with the daughter-in-law. But still, if you read the genealogy of Jesus, you that you are so holy and pure, you are not inside. Because the covenant has the ability to reconcile deadly people, reconcile unclean people, reconcile bad people back to God. That was the job of Jesus. He came for the deadliest, the ugliest, and the baddest guy in town. So if you are here, even if the record of your life is dirty, I'm presenting to you today a God that has the capability overnight and in a minute, in a second, to rewrite the story of your life.
Amen.
And today I stand as a book writer.
I receive
and I rewrite the story of your life.
I receive it.
You are moving from the level where you are into where you ought to be. In the name of Jesus.
Wow.
In that genealogy, do you know Moses is not even in the genealogy of Jesus? Does that not shock you? Look at the names of people, my friends. There was a lady inside called Ruth. Do you know in the Bible, all the people that have two names were the most controversial and the most cursed people? Do you know why? In Bible, we don't have two names. Like in these days, some people can be called William Alfred. So surname is Alfred, first name is William. There is no first name and surname in the Bible. Have you seen it? We didn't call him Isaac Abraham. His name is Isaac. That name was the symbol of an identity. Something was carrying upon his life. Because Isaac meant laughter. So the name they were given depended on what they carried upon their lives or the event that occurred before their birth or the event that occurred in the day of their birth. And this man of God in this house is called Isaac. No wonder you shall laugh. You will laugh at your enemy.
I receive it.
No wonder in this atmosphere, I use his name and I paste it on your life.
I
use his name and I put it on you. I decree, you shall laugh this year, 2017. In this seventh month, the month of July, you shall laugh. You shall laugh in the name of Jesus. It is Ruth. She was called Ruth the Moabite. You know why they put the Moabite? Why didn't they call Tamar, putting something beside the name of Tamar? But when it came to Rahab, they say Rahab the prostitute. They always added something. Blind Bartimaeus. They were always adding something to those people's life. But Jesus had come for them. That's what the devil forgot. So they can give you a name. They can call you names. Jesus, we give you a name.
I receive it.
The Bible didn't say he received names. He said he received a name above every other name.
Oh.
That in that name, every knee should bow.
Amen.
Because you are in a covenant with Jesus, you have his name. Therefore, whoever will see you, we bow.
I receive it.
Every situation that will be confronted with you, we bow. Every problem that will work against you, we bow. Because you've got the name of Jesus. You've got the name of the Messiah. You've got the name of the Savior. Anyone that will see you shall bow. And the tongues of your neighbor, the tongues in your family shall confess that Jesus is the Lord to the glory of the Father. He has received a name. That name is for us also.
Amen.
That in the name of Jesus. So when they see me, I am not called Thierry in the realms of the spirit. I am Jesus.
Oh.
I am the junior brother of Jesus. So our family name, our surname, our first name, our middle name is Jesus. We don't have first name, surname, all the. We don't have all that. We have a name. Come and tell your neighbor, we have a name.
We have a name.
And that name is above every other name.
That's
the name of the Savior.
The name of the Savior.
Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the Son of the living God. He was, he is, and is to come. He was in the days of Moses, but he is in your life. And he shall be at the rapture. He shall be in the last days. God decided deliberately to tell Matthew, when you will take your pen and your ink and write the genealogy of Jesus, don't go and jump and put Adam inside. Don't go and put Noah inside. Do you see all these good people? Enoch was not inside. Noah was not in the genealogy of Jesus. All these good people, good guys. I mean, but you, the bad guy, you are inside.
Oh.
You, the woman that was called a prostitute, you are now the grandmother of Jesus. Because let me tell you something. When God is looking at you, he doesn't see you. He sees your destiny. So when people are busy condemning you, God is busy pushing you to your destiny. God is busy pushing you to your destiny. Can I preach?
Oh, yes.
They have called them all names, but God gave them a name. Because when the genealogy ended, the Bible said, we have 14 generations from Abraham to David. 14 generations from David to the deportation in Babylon. And 14 generations from Babylon to Christ. The Bible didn't say Jesus. Do you know why he said Christ? Christ means Amashiach. Amashiach in Hebrew means anointed. So he's talking about a generation of anointed men and women. You and I, we have been anointed. And what is an anointing? An anointing is something you don't ask. It's something you don't demand.
Uh-huh.
But you are giving it.
Amen.
You may not be qualified for it. You may be at the backside of the desert taking care of the sheep of daddy and mommy. But the anointing is coming to you. The anointing is walking to the backside of the desert.
Amen.
Am I talking to somebody today?
Oh, yes.
David was busy taking care of his father's sheep, going about the lion and the bear, but the anointing was running after David. What you have not asked for is asking for you. And I have come with that environment. I have come with that cloud over me. Whatever you didn't look for, as from tonight, they shall begin to look for you.
I receive it.
That beautiful man, when you were looking at him, you couldn't even think that he could be your husband. It shall come to you. That company you thought that you were not qualified to work there. I mean, something will happen. There will be a reshuffle in the government. They will begin to look for you.
I receive it.
I am feeling an anointing over me. There is a shift in the realms of the spirit. People are leaving your horses and you are sitting on your horses.
I receive it.
People are coming down of your chariot. You are getting to your chariot.
I receive it.
Do you know what the covenant does? The covenant reshuffles environment.
Ah.
And I want to speak today. I'm an
an apostle, but I want to borrow the prophetic mantle of my brother. Can I borrow it? And I want to prophesy.
Prophesy.
There will be a reshuffle in the government. Somebody for your family will be appointed. Somebody in your bloodline will be appointed in the name of Jesus. Yeah, I know it will happen. It will happen. There is somebody in this place. You will come here and testify. Somebody in your family will be appointed in the government. Do you know what the covenant does? The covenant removes the fraudster and puts the man that was destined for it. I want to say something that will shock you, and I'm saying it under control of my brother, because this is very brutal. Tell your neighbor it's brutal.
It's brutal.
A man by the name of Saul went to sit on a throne, and this is exactly what I'm going to do tonight for you. I want to decree only one word over your life. That word, it will follow you.
I receive it.
Like mosquito following somebody to bite him. That word will follow you.
I receive
and push you to your destiny.
I receive it.
A man by the name of Jacob, he called his 12 children and he said, "You Judah, the scepter shall not depart from thee." He said, "The scepter shall not depart from thee." And the scepter, look, the scepter wanted to depart from Judah. Do you know how? One day, somebody lost his asses, and his son began to look for his asses. And what the man was not qualified to have, God had to talk to Samuel, and he said, "Samuel, give it to him. But it's for a short period." Tell your neighbor, it's for a short period.
It's for a short period.
Those that went ahead of you, it's for a short period. Those that got married before you, it's for a short period.
Amen.
Saul was anointed. It was an error. Tell your neighbor, it was an error. I can say it. I have swallowed this Bible. I can say it. Do you know why it was an error? Because God respects the patriarchs. A patriarch by the name of Yisrael. Because at that time, he was no longer Jacob. He was now Yisrael, a prince with the Lord. So somebody sitting in God's council, he called his children. He said, "Come, let me tell you what will happen in the latter days." So Jacob was under the prophetic anointing. And the prophecy, he never misses his target. He said, "Judah, the scepter shall not depart from thee until Shiloh comes." You know where is the Shiloh? It's Jesus. But somebody, Saul, was anointed as a king. Says it was an error.
It was an error.
Now, the words of Jacob entered a boss called 1 Samuel. That was the name of the boss. The word of Jacob traveled from a city called Genesis chapter 49. Look at the signboard of another city that was called 1 Samuel. And that word traveled from Genesis 49 to 1 Samuel and came and said, "What's going on here? What's going on?" Jacob said, "The scepter shall not depart from Judah." How come the scepter found itself in another family? I have come to restore something. I have come to restore order. I have come to restore the prophecy. I have come to revive whatever has been spoken over your life. How come the scepter went to the Benjamite? Saul was a Benjamite. He was not from the tribe of Judah. How come the scepter went to Benjamin? Samuel, you got to do the work. You are the one that ordained, that anointed Saul as a king. You got to go and cross-line the whole process and go and boycott the process. Go and give it back to somebody called David. Because he's the one entitled for that grace. It was an error from someone from the loins of Benjamin to sit on the throne of Israel. That is why the word began to fight the man Saul. He began to make mistakes he ought not to make. I prophesy in this environment.
I receive it.
And I am kneeling down as an apostle.
I receive it.
When I will rise, I decree over your life, your enemies will begin to make mistakes as of today.
I receive it.
They will begin to make costly mistakes, deadly mistakes, that will remove them from where they are. And you will be positioned. You will be positioned in the name of Jesus. They will begin to make that mistake tonight. Somebody in your workplace will begin to make that mistake.
I receive.
Someone that was fighting your position, your promotion, he will make the mistake that will cost him his job. And you have to sit there because the Bible says, I have seen an error under the sun.
Oh.
Princes are walking barefooted. And slaves, it means idiots, are riding on the chariots.
Oh.
As from tonight, those idiots will come down. As from tonight, those slaves will come down. How dare you? How dare you sit on my chariot? How dare you sit on my horse? Tell your neighbor, it is mine.
It is mine.
It's not yours.
It's not yours.
It is mine.
It is mine.
What is mine is mine.
What is mine is mine.
You can't take what belongs to me.
You can't take what belongs to me.
Because I don't take what belongs to you.
I don't take what belongs to you.
There's an error that will be corrected tonight.
Amen. Power.
The Bible says there are three things that bear witness under the earth. Amen. The Bible said we have water, we have blood. And I always like to end up with that message because I was one day in Abuja and I was preaching somewhere and God corrected me on something and I understood that revelation. The Bible said there are three that bear witness on the earth. We have water, we have blood, and we have spirit. Not the Holy Spirit, because the verse before that says there are three that bear witness in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. Why the Word was a witness in heaven? Because the Son was on earth. So whilst you are here and you have left your house, you have left your things, the word the prophet has spoken for years over your life is attending to whatever belongs to you. Is watching over you. Jesus was on earth, but the word was a witness in heaven for him. There is a word tonight that is speaking for you.
Oh yes.
There is a word that is reorganizing something for you.
I receive it.
There is a word. There is a word. I said there is a word. There is a word. There is a word. There is a word fighting your enemies tonight. There is a word fighting your competitors tonight. There is a word. There is a word. Jesus was on earth. He was on the cross. And look what happened. The Bible says in the book of 1 John, chapter 6 to 8, there are three that bear witness on the earth, water, blood, and spirit. And you know what? When Jesus was on the cross, the three witnesses traveled to the cross and said, Jesus, here we are. We need to go back to heaven and witness for you. So what do we have to do? Jesus said, Isaiah said of me, that none of his bones will be broken. So when he was on that cross, the first thing that happened, blood began to rush down. So the element of blood was standing at Calvary. He used one chair, he sat on it, and he said, hey, I am there. So we are fulfilling the scriptures because Jesus on that cross was fulfilling the covenant. He was cutting himself. His blood was coming down like the seven stages I mentioned because he needed to establish a new covenant. Not a covenant that will come and blame the former, but the former was a faulty covenant. He needed to bring a better covenant. He needed to bring a spotless and a blameless covenant. Why? Because no covenant can be established without the blood. So he didn't bring a sacrificial animal. He became the sacrificial lamb. He didn't bring anything. He brought himself. Now the second thing that happened on the cross, water came out of his side. That was the birth of the church, the birth of a new creed of people, the birth of the Jesus generation.
Amen.
Tell your neighbor, I am the Jesus generation.
I am the Jesus generation.
And the third thing that happened, he said, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. In Hebrew it means, Father, Father, why art thou forsaking me? The Father kept quiet. Because the Father was like the people I mentioned. We needed to choose a place for the covenant for people to watch the covenant, like on the television. So God became a spectator. He said, wow, we are getting close to the end and fulfilling all the scriptures. So from Genesis to Revelation, Jesus gathered through his body the entirety of the scriptures, the 66 books of the Bible, and he fulfilled them. He nailed everything on that cross by becoming himself the sacrificial lamb.
don't come in the presence of a spirit without water and blood. For him to enter into the Holy of Holies and to stand as our high priest and to fulfill all sacrificial duties, he needed to come with blood and he needed to come with water. White blood. Blood is the only substance that never dies, because that's the only voice in the realms of the spirit. Don't forget, the Bible said the blood of Abel began to cry to God and ask for vengeance. So when Jesus, if you understand what Jesus did, the blood of Jesus will begin to speak from the corridors of eternity into your time, into your life, and the blood of Jesus will begin to silence and mute the voice of your accusers. If you understand that that blood was shed for you and I, you will begin to use the blood. You will begin to apply the blood and command that every voice speaking against you should be muted, because the blood is speaking. The blood is speaking.
Amen.
And water stands for human being, because the human body is made of 75% water. So you represent the water. The spirit represents God. What is the blood in your hand? Let me tell you something, and I'm not afraid to say it. It is normal. I will ask all of you today to sow. Let me tell you why. I always say it here. Prophetess, you remember where I said it. It is dangerous and it's abnormal to come in God's presence without emptying yourself from your blood. Do you know why? Let's go back. Those of you that like to always argue with Bible realities. In the Old Testament, in the tabernacle, at the entrance, there was an altar. So as soon as you enter, you have to begin to sacrifice. Because we were not going to church in those days. In the Old Testament, we were not going to church to come and dance. They were not even going to sit and hear the words. That's why I say you are blessed. When they were going, everybody was carrying his lamp on his shoulder. And say, Oga High Priest, I have come. This is my lamp. Okay, I have seen. So do the thing for me. So the high priest will carry the sacrificial animal and he will enter into the holy place. There you have the basin, you have the shewbread. And then he will go and fulfill all things. And then he will enter into the Holy of Holies and go and ask for the atonement of sins. It means the expiation, the removal, the taking away of their sins. And then he comes out. So if you come to the church without that mentality, it is dangerous. It is very dangerous. We don't come to the house of God without blood. Something must pain you, because you don't have to go and do animal sacrifice. It is forbidden, because Christ is the best sacrifice. The only thing that now stands in the new dispensation in which we are, that stands for blood, is whatever you do in the house of God that pains you. Whatever you do for God that pains you, that's what stands for blood. Some of you, when they just tell them small thing in the church, and the man of God has insulted me, I'm no longer going to that church. My friend, get out if you want. Jesus said, I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail. How dare you say, I'm going, go. It is, the Bible said the Holy Spirit is the master of the harvest, not you. You are a product of his harvest. So he can always reproduce the harvest, if you don't know. What mentality do you carry when you come to church? How do you see the man that is there? How do you see the woman God has placed in this? How do you see them? My friend, let me tell you, change. Because if you want to go back according to Bible realities, some of you, when they come to church, you will not even have the audacity to even look at the man of God in his eyes. If you want to go through what the Bible says, some of you should not even lift up their head and look at the man of God. We are in a generation of grace, but it shouldn't be a generation of disgrace.
Amen.
It shouldn't be a generation of disgrace. The other day, Papa Talena was saying here, he said, even if you have seen the nakedness of your father, shut up. Tell your neighbor, shut up.
Shut up.
Don't be afraid to tell him, shut up. I will pay the bill if he's angry. Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, shut up. You haven't seen anything. Or are you a prophet? Do you see? So what do you see? If what you see does not edify, shut up. It should be for the edification of the body of Christ. So if what you tell me does not edify me, my friend, shut up. with capital letter, shut up. So Jesus, the Bible says, he entered once and for all in the Holy of Holies, not with the sacrifice of an animal, but he himself becoming the sacrificial lamb. So let's rise up. Say hallelujah. Say I receive. You are blessed. Say I receive.
I receive.
You are blessed.
I receive.
Say I receive.
I receive.
You are blessed, my friend. Look at your neighbor. Something is changing about your neighbor. Look at his face. It wasn't the way it was in the beginning. Something is changing. You are becoming more beautiful than ever before. Hallelujah. I want you to do something with me. Take something that will pain you. I mean, if it doesn't pain you, don't come here. Don't come. Take something that pains you. When you look at it, it should pain you. It should even brutalize you. And come and stand here. We're going to do something. I will not tell you. Because if I tell you, all of you will rush to this place. Take something that pains you in your hand. Come here. And I will give the mic to the man of God. Take something in your bag, in your pocket. Some of you are even hiding something in their clothes. Remove it. We are not asking for an animal. We want to enter into accomplishment. God will preach tonight. Because every word carries its spirit. Jesus said in the book of John